In the Old Testament, Jesus said, "All who hate me love death." Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Accepting him as your Lord and Savior and choosing to follow him puts you on the way. Obeying the truth of God's word keeps you on the way that ends in eternal life. Your eternal destiny will be determined by your choices in this world. Steps to Life exists to help people find the way, the truth, and the life.
You believe in heaven when you go to church that you're going to hear stories? I do. You can think that one over yourself. I want to study a subject with you this morning that is a very sacred subject. I want to study a text of scripture with you. Actually, I've never preached about before. And this can be a very emotional subject, and I try to stay away from emotional preaching, emotional subjects, but there is some emotion involved in religion, and it's unavoidable. And so, before we study, let's pray that the Lord will help us to understand what we're going to study, not just the emotional part of it, but also the spiritual, intellectual part of it. Father in heaven, we come to you as little children, recognizing that without your Spirit, without your Holy Spirit working on our minds, we will not understand spiritual things. And so we earnestly pray that as we study about our Savior, our great High Priest in heaven, that you'll open our minds to understand the truth. We pray this in Jesus' name for his sake. Amen. As I said, this is a text of Scripture that I have never preached about before. And it is a very familiar and favorite text of Scripture for many Christians. It actually is a text, I suppose, that I could quote, have been able to quote for over 50 years. And one of the reasons this is such a favorite text is because this text of Scripture tells us some wonderful things about the nature of our great High Priest in heaven. By the way, just as an aside, are you all aware of the fact that Ellen White says in the book Great Controversy that Jesus' work as our great High Priest in heaven is just as necessary to our salvation as his death on the cross? Are you aware of that? The majority of the Christian world are not aware of that today. They know that Jesus died for our sins, but they don't understand that he is ministering today as our great High Priest in heaven, and without his ministration in heaven, we would be lost, even though he died on the cross. Well, that's not our subject today. I want to preach about that sometime. I'm hoping, if the Lord wills, to say something about that during our camp meeting that's coming up. But let's go to the text. If you have your Bible, open it to Hebrews, the 4th chapter. And we're just going to study one verse. Now, I have preached about several verses in Hebrews 4, and I love this chapter. But although I've preached on almost every verse in the chapter, I haven't preached on the last verses. And one of the last verses I want to study with you today, and it's verse 15. It's a wonderful, wonderful verse. Look at what it says. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. There are several reasons, by the way, that I have not preached on this text before. And one of the reasons that I have not preached about this text before is because of the Baker letter. And I want to read to you just one sentence from the Baker letter, what it says about this verse. This is from the Baker letter. It was written in 1895. Quote, "It is a mystery left unexplained to mortals that Christ could be tempted in all points like as we are, yet be without sin." Well, I read that many years ago. And in my mind, I thought, well, might as well not preach about that verse. This is a mystery that is left unexplained to mortals. This is a mystery that nobody can understand. And so I'm not going to preach on that verse. Trouble is, this verse is in the Bible. And actually, as I have thought about it since that time, because I have made that decision many times, I'm not going to preach about that verse. Nobody can understand that verse. Ellen White says nobody can understand that verse. I'm not going to preach about that verse. But actually, are you aware of the fact that if you preach the gospel, we're preaching about things we don't understand all the time? We understand a little bit of it, but there's a much bigger understanding than what we have. So I become convicted that I need to preach about this verse too, as well as the other verses in Hebrews 4, which I preach many, many sermons about. Since I read this statement from the Baker letter that explains why I have not preached on this verse before, perhaps it is most appropriate that I say something about the Baker letter, which has turned out to be one of the best known and one of the most controversial of all the Ellen White letters. Elder Baker was a Seventh-day Adventist minister. If my memory serves me correctly, his native state was the state of Iowa. So he was a Midwestern United States citizen. But he went as a missionary to Australia. And he did evangelism in Australia and in Tasmania with his wife. And evidently, Elder Baker and his wife in their evangelistic work became very discouraged. One of the main purposes of the Baker letter was to encourage a discouraged minister and his wife. They had been become discouraged in their evangelistic efforts. By the way, friend, maybe there's somebody here maybe there's somebody here that's suffering from discouragement. Let me just say a word about that. God knows every detail about every discouragement that you are going through. And at just the right time, God sends to His workers, His children, encouragement when they're in discouraging circumstances. I've seen that happen over and over again. Let me tell you a quick story. When I was a young minister, I was working in Grand Forks, North Dakota. We were doing evangelistic work. We were having public evangelistic meetings. And the evangelist that I was working with, I was the pastor of the church. He was the conference evangelist. And his name was Ben Green. He's one of my favorite people. I love Ben Green. But you know, there are sacrifices involved in doing evangelistic work. And Ben Green was there in North Dakota. We were conducting these evangelistic meetings, but his home was way over 100 miles away. And the house my wife and I were living in was not big enough to house his family. He and his wife and his two daughters, young daughters, we're living actually in a motel. He told me this story one day. He said it was Friday night, the beginning of the Sabbath. My two daughters had gotten sick, both of them. And they were running fevers that were so high. My wife and I are saying, what are we going to do? We're going to have to take them to the emergency room? What are we going to do?
And here you're away from home, you're in a motel room, and your daughters are sick, and you're holding meetings every night, and you're visiting people in the daytime, holding meetings at night, and you're so busy you can... And you've got two daughters that are sick. What do you... And he became so discouraged over this situation that had developed. He said, "Lord, what am I going to do? Am I going to have to quit doing evangelism and take my daughters home and take them to the hospital, take them somewhere just to see that they get better so they don't die?" He was praying about it and telling the Lord. He was just so discouraged because he was trying to do the Lord. Have you ever been in a situation when you're trying to do what's right and then it just seems everything goes wrong? That was the situation he was in. He was trying to do what's right. He was trying to do God's work. Now his daughters are so sick, he's afraid he's going to have to quit. He doesn't know what to do. He told me, he said, "The Lord heard my prayer." Now, we don't know exactly what the Lord does. All the Lord needs to do is speak. It happened just within a matter of minutes after he prayed. His wife looked at their daughters, the color had changed. He said, "Let's put the thermometer in again." The thermometer registered perfectly normal for both of them. The Lord heard his prayer. He was in agony. He was in discouragement, but the Lord knew his situation. He said, "No, I'm going to put my hand on this. You need to keep doing my work." And my friend, if there's somebody here today, If you're just surrounded by discouraging circumstances, if you're a Christian and you call upon the Lord is going to help you. When you need help the most, He's going to be there. Now, when God sends comfort, and that's what the Lord was trying to do for Elder Baker and his wife, because they were both discouraged, it's evident from the letters. When the Lord sends to you comfort, when you're discouraged in a difficult situation, often, the Lord also sends some correction. And the purpose of the correction is to help us to become more efficient in His service. And so, the Baker letter contains not only comfort and encouragement, but it also contains some correction. Elder Baker was a prominent Seventh-day Adventist minister who became the president of a number of conferences in Australia. Later in life, he returned back to the United States. If my memory serves me correctly, I believe he spent his last years in Colorado Springs, Colorado. He died in 1933. The reason that the Baker letter has become so well known and so controversial is because it contains plain, explicit, strong statements about the nature of Christ that completely contradict and destroy the position, the theological position of many conservative Seventh-day Adventist ministers and teachers that they have espoused. Now, when I first read these statements in the Baker letter, it was no problem for me because I had already read Testimonies for the Church, Volume 2, page 202, and so I was clear and straight and settled in my thinking about the nature of Christ, so I didn't have any problem with the Baker letter. However, that was not the case for almost everybody around me. And through the years, I have listened and read and watched over and over again as Seventh-day Adventist ministers and theologians have attempted to explain away the Baker letter. They had to some way explain it away because if you just accepted what it said, it destroyed their belief, their belief system. It destroyed their theology about the nature of Christ. And so all manner of methods have been devised to try to explain it. I one time listened to Elder Ralph Larson say that he believed that Elder Baker probably had a problem with the adoptionist theory, and that Ellen White was trying to correct that in this letter. And that could easily be true. We can't prove it, but that could easily be true. However, if that is all you get out of the Baker letter, you have completely missed the main points and main thrusts of the letter. My brother reported to me what he had learned at the Seventh-day Adventist Seminary from certain conservative professors about the Baker letter. In brief, they said, well, we shouldn't try to establish doctrine from just a private letter. I thought that's the most interesting explanation I've ever heard. These very same ministers, if they find a private letter written to a prominent Seventh-day Adventist minister on something that they agree with, they want you to accept it and believe it without asking any questions. If you accept the Baker letter at face value, you will realize immediately that it completely destroys the positions on the nature of Christ taken by Elder Herbert Douglas and many a host of other conservative Adventist ministers and theologians and teachers, many of whom are and have been friends of mine. And so I have never preached a sermon about the Baker letter, and I hope to God that I never will be required by Him to do so, because I have no desire to pour salt in the wounds of my friends. Now, when I was young, you didn't have access to the Baker letter. You just could read excerpts from it. But today, of course, you can read the whole thing. If you have, this is 13 manuscript releases. If you have 13 manuscript releases, the Baker letter starts on about page 14. You can read the whole thing. Interestingly enough, before they put the Baker letter in here, they do something they very rarely do in the manuscript releases. They have a whole page of explanation about the Baker letter. I can make a lot of comments about that, but we're going to run out of time. I can't get involved in that. It's very uncommon for the White Estate to put a whole page of explanation about a manuscript release before they put it in, but that's another story. We'll leave that one out for now. Let's go to our text. The text that I can't understand, that no human being can understand. And yet it's in the Bible. So we should try to understand as much as we can about it. We do not have a high priest who cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. There are many today who refer to this Bible text as a proof text that Jesus had the same natural tendencies or propensities to sin that fallen men have. Nobody knows this better than me. Many years ago, I've been in many churches where controversies arose over the nature of Christ. One was when we were living in Chehalis, Washington. And so a friend of mine came to my house, and he started asking me questions about the nature of Christ. I didn't know what was going on, but I just listened to the questions, and I tried to give him the... He was not a theologian, didn't have college education or training. I tried to answer his questions about the nature of Christ as simply as I knew how. About a day later, he came to my door. He says, "You're wrong." "Oh, why is that so? What is it?" "Well," he quoted this text, "you're wrong because it says this." I thought, that's interesting. His proof text is a text that Ellen White says that no human being can explain. So I think it's time for me to be quiet. I've been in situations like that many, many times. Inspiration teaches that our tendency to wrongdoing is an imperfection of character. We've studied that already. And that imperfection of character is sin. But Paul says here that even though Jesus was tempted in all points like as we are, He was without sin. So, we can't understand it all. We know that. But we want to understand as much as we can. So, we want to understand three things. First of all, what does it mean when it says He is touched with the feelings of our infirmities? He is touched
with your feelings. The second thing we want to understand has to do with all points. And this is a very interesting thing to try to study. Is then, if you look at the introduction to this manuscript release in manuscript 13, this letter was written in 1895. It was not released so that you and I could just read it for 88 years. You know why they released it? Because it mentions it. It tells why. Because Elder Raul Dederin, who is a teacher of the seminary, he was one of my teachers, by the way, he was teaching the class in Christology. I did not take his class in Christology. However, I was one of the Seventh-day Adventist ministers in the North Dakota Conference that was there when Elder Dederin, Dr. Dederin, came to the North Dakota Conference, and he gave a series of lectures about the nature of Christ. So I know something about what Dr. Dederin believed about the nature of Christ. I believe he's dead now. And so I have a very good idea about why he and the members of his class wanted to have this statement, and they finally released it because of their request. But one of the things he studied with this, and we studied for a long time, the ministers in North Dakota, about what does this mean when he was tempted in all points, like as I am. Women should study the Bible too. And women have minds that are just as good as men's, just in case you're wondering. A woman's mind, by the way, this has been demonstrated scientifically, a woman's mind is just as good as a man's mind. There is no difference in their IQ. They just think differently, that's all. Their mind is wired differently, but it's not inferior. And Elder Dederin's wife, and I had never heard this before until he mentioned it when the ministers in North Dakota were studying. Elder Dederin's wife came to him one day and she said, "It says here in this text that Christ was tempted in all points like as we are. And the question I want to ask is, how could Christ be tempted as a woman? Because he wasn't a woman." Well, that provided a lot of thing to think about for the ministers in that day. We won't go over that right now, but we want to understand, what does this mean when it says he was tempted in all points? We can't explain it, but we need to understand as much as we can. That's the second. The third thing, he was tempted. Christ was tempted. And he was tempted as we are. And this is something that I wanted to understand for many years. How could Christ be tempted as I am? I know I'm tempted. Do you know you're tempted? And let me tell you, friends, when I started to find the answer as to how Christ was tempted as I'm tempted, got so scared, I began to say something to the Lord like, "Lord, I will walk softly on tiptoe before you all the days of my life, even in heaven." This is a sacred subject we're about to study. I have it down here, but I think we better skip it. I had it down here about the Greek word that's translated, touched with a feeling. We're short of time. I have to stay away from Greek words. It means that he feels sympathy. That's what it means. He has sympathy for you. By the way, friend of mine, do you like the idea that you have somebody that is standing at the throne of God in heaven, who has all power, who is touched with your feelings? You like that idea? It's true. This verse tells us it's so. He is able to sympathize with your problem. And so you should feel free to come to him and to talk to him about any problem that you have. Do you believe that? Don't go through life trying to bear your problems and burdens all by yourself. there's somebody that is touched with the problem that you have. And so Paul says to the despiser, you need to come with confidence, with assurance to the throne of grace, because you're going to find mercy and you're going to find grace to help in time of need. Pray for me that I don't become emotional. Let me read the statement from Desire of Ages, page 329. The elder brother of our race is by the eternal throne. He looks upon every soul who is turning his face toward him as the Savior. He knows by experience what are the weaknesses of humanity, what are our wants, and where lies the strength of our temptations. He knows what makes the temptation you're dealing with so difficult for you to overcome and why it just seems like you can't overcome. He knows that. He understands that. My dear friend, that should give you confidence in Him. Because He's promised that He's going to deliver you and make you a victor over all sin and sinful temptations. He knows what are the wants. He knows what are, by experience, what are the weaknesses of humanity, what are our wants, and where lies the strength of our temptations. For He was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Now, notice here this statement in Desire of Ages, page 329. Talks says that He understands what our weaknesses are. He understands what our wants are. And He understands wherein lies the strength of our temptations. Now, what are human wants? When you talk about a person's wants, what is a want? You know what the Bible says? Let's see. I don't know that it says this in modern translations, but in the Old King James it says it. It says in Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not what? Want. What do new translations translate that as? Lack. Usually lack. I shall not lack. What is a want? Well, go to the dictionary again. A want is something that is not possessed. You don't have it, but it is desired. You don't have it, but you want it. That's what a want is. And why do you want it? Well, you want it for one of two reasons. You either want it so you can use it, or you want it for reasons of pleasure. So a want is something that is desired, whether it be a desire for something needed or a desire for pleasure. So the weaknesses of humanity lie in the desire for life's necessities and pleasures. Now, how does Jesus know by experience what are the weaknesses of humanity, what are our wants? Let's read this statement from 16 manuscript releases. Page 181. It says, a man of our flesh, he was compassed with the weakness of humanity. The circumstances of his life were of that character that he was exposed to all the inconveniences that belong to men, not in wealth, not in ease, but in poverty and want and humiliation. Notice it says he was surrounded by these things. He experienced poverty, want, humiliation. 14 manuscript releases, page 334. We know that the Lord Jesus was tempted in all points like as we are, and he knows how to succor, that is how to help, all who shall be tempted. I want to dwell on that point for just a moment because it's so important. We need to understand that when you are tempted, whatever the temptation is,
that Jesus knows how to help you. And when you're tempted and it seems like there's no way out and you're going to lose and you're going to fall every time and you're never going to win, my dear friend, at that very time, that's a time of all times when you need to be crying out to the Lord and say, Lord, you have promised that you're going to help me to overcome and to deliver me from this temptation. You promised that. Now, by the way, I want to say something that's not so pleasant for us here too. As human beings, we seem to think, I've been at fault with this as much as any human being. I know I have. In our human mind, our mind can see helping me means that you take the temptation away. That's the way we want the Lord to take the temptation. Just deliver me from the temptation. My dear friend, very often that's not the way it works. Sometimes it does work that way. Sometimes the Lord says, okay, you're not going to have that. I'm going to take that away. That happens sometimes. I've had people come to me and say, you know, I was smoking this many packs of cigarettes a day. And when I tried to stop smoking, I couldn't do it. And I got so desperate, I just cried out and said, Lord, help me. And the Lord heard my prayer, and bang, just like that. All desire for tobacco was taken away from me, and I've never desired it since. So sometimes that's the way it is. Sometimes the Lord takes the temptation away. But more often, it works a different way. More often, the Lord does not take the temptation away. His will is not to take the temptation away, but for you and for me to overcome the temptation and not yield to it. Did the three Hebrew worthies have that experience? They had that exact experience. They said, our God is able to deliver us from you, O King. But if not, let it be known, we are not going to worship your gods. And the king says, all right, that's what you've chosen. We're going to heat the fire up. He was so angry, he says, we're going to heat the fire up seven times hotter than ever before, and we're going to throw him in, and we'll see who. God didn't keep them from getting thrown into the fire. I've often thought in my mind, what was going through their minds? Their hands were being bound. Their feet were being bound. You can't move. And then after you're bound so you can't move, you're going to throw you into this fire. Now, it's one thing after you're there and you're walking around and the Lord's with you. That's different. But when your hands are being bound and your feet are being bound and you're getting lifted up by strong military soldiers and they're getting ready to throw you, have you ever wondered what was going through their minds? They had decided, well, Lord, Even if I die because I chose not to worship idols, I'm going to be faithful to you. Why do I mention that? Because, my dear friends, if you live until the end of the world, it's going to look like, over and over again, that you are going to get killed. It's going to look like that. The Bible predicts that. There's going to be, Revelation 13 says there's a time coming when if you are faithful, if you will not kneel down and worship the image of the beast, you will be killed. It's going to look like you're going to get killed. Did it look to them like they're going to get killed? It sure did. Surely did. If you're going to be faithful, one of God's children at the end of the world, you're going to have to come to the place where you say, Lord, you don't just say that to the Lord, you say to everybody else, this is what I believe. I'm going to keep the law of God even if you kill me for doing it. And of course, the law of God forbids worshiping idols. That's the second longest commandment in the law. So, Jesus, because of his own experience, he knows, because of his experience, he knows how to help you, whatever your temptation is. Let me read a little bit more about what he endured, of how he got this experience. This is 14 manuscript releases, page 334. This is one of these statements in the spirit of prophecy you have to think through for a long time before it gradually soaks in. All of a sudden, it's like somebody hits you on the head with something when you realize what's involved in this. Now, listen to this statement. In his humanity, he suffered physical weariness, weakness, hunger, thirst, and sadness. Five things.
Now, when I first read that, I was so dull, I didn't think that much about it. Well, I've suffered all those things. I've been weak, I've been hungry, I've been thirsty, I've been sad because when I've gone to funerals of my loved ones, I've been sad, I've experienced all the... Wait a minute.
I'm just a creature. I'm a created being. He was the creator.
He created all things. He is the source of all strength and power. He's the one, the Bible says, that upholds the heavenly bodies in their train march around the universe. He's the one that holds all that in place. That's the kind of power and ability He has. And somebody like that that's willing to lay all that aside in order to save me, willing to come and man had to suffer like I have to suffer? Hunger, thirst, weakness, sadness.
My friend, when you start to think about this, you will realize that this is humiliation beyond your comprehension to understand.
Jesus was not only touched with the feeling of our infirmities by His physical suffering, in poverty, wants, and humiliation, He was also touched with the feeling of our infirmities by experiencing the strength of our temptations.
Review and Herald, March 18, 1875.
By experiencing in Himself the strength of Satan's temptation and of human sufferings and infirmities, He would know how to succor, that's help, those who should put forth efforts to help themselves.
Now let's think this through. What is the strength of temptation?
Ministry of Healing, page 174. Feeling the terrible power of temptation, the drawing of desire that leads to indulgence, many a man cries in despair, I cannot resist evil. Have you ever heard anybody say that?
That's common. She says, many a man cries out in despair, I cannot resist evil. By the way, a person that's in that mindset is fertile territory for some preacher that comes along preaching the new theology that you don't need to overcome. And that's one reason that kind of theology is so popular with so many people. They've been there. I tried 1,000 times. I couldn't do it. She calls it the terrible power of temptation. Have you experienced it? The drawing of desire that finally leads to indulgence. I could spend a lot of time describing that to you by telling you actual stories, but I don't want to get into storytelling. Desire is a power of the mind. The strength, the terrible power of temptation lies in the wants, the desires of man. Keep in mind that infirmities are related to either a weakness of the body or a weakness of the mind. There is an intimate relationship between the weaknesses of humanity and the strength or power of temptation. The greater the desire, the more powerful is the temptation. Does that make sense to you? The greater the desire, the stronger is the power of temptation. Now, inspiration also describes the actions and motives of the weakness of humanity. This is from Faith I Live By, page 140. God requires every soul to be pure and holy. We have hereditary tendencies to wrong. This is a part of self that no one need carry about. It is a weakness of humanity to pet selfishness,
because it is a natural trait of character. But unless all selfishness is put away, unless self is crucified, we can never be holy as God is holy. By the way, if there's anybody here and you're struggling to understand what Paul is talking about in Romans 6, and he talks about the crucifying of the old man, that's what he's talking about. Crucifying the old man is crucifying my natural selfishness. That's what it's about. Putting that to death. It is a weakness of humanity to pet selfishness because, she says, it is a natural trait of character. Now, a superficial reading of these passages by people who have permitted their minds to become beclouded in regard to what constitutes sin can lead to the gross error of attributing to the humanity of Christ the same tendencies to wrong, to sin, that we inherit from Adam. Ellen White wrote in 19:2, "The sowing of seeds of selfishness in the human heart was the first result of the entrance of sin into the world." What was the first result of the entrance of sin into the world? It happened on the very day that Adam and Eve sinned. What happened? The seed of selfishness was sown in their heart. Now, what is selfishness? You know what it is. Review and Herald, May 23, 1907. All selfishness is covetousness and is therefore idolatry. Well, now let me ask you this. Is idolatry sin? Well, if idolatry is sin, that's the second commandment, then selfishness is sin. If all selfishness is covetousness and idolatry, then all selfishness is sin, and sin is a transgression of the law in whatever form or fashion that it is found. The law, Desire of Ages, page 762. The law requires righteousness, a righteous life, a perfect character, and this man has not to give. I don't have to give it. You don't have it to give. Adam disobeyed and entailed sin upon his posterity. But God gave his son for the redemption of the race. Our tendencies, our inherited tendencies to wrong, are the result of our natural selfishness, which is the root cause of our natural tendencies to sin. The crucial point to understand is that it is a weakness of humanity to pet the natural trait of character. The natural trait of character in sinful humanity is selfishness. But there was not one thread of selfishness in the humanity of Christ. So then, here's the question. How does Jesus know what the weakness of humanity is like? Well, I'm just about out of time, but let's go back to Hebrews 2:18 and combine that with what we've just read. Open your Bible to Hebrews 2:18. This is also, all the Bible is holy and sacred, but the texts we're studying today are especially holy and sacred. I don't feel confident to preach about this text either, but it's here in Hebrews 2:18. It says, "For in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he is able to aid those who are tempted." And Hebrews 4:15 says, "We have not an high priest who cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin." So, what is this telling us? What is this teaching us? Christ triumphant says, "Thank God we have a high priest who is touched with the feelings of our infirmities, for he was in all points tempted as we are." Now, if you listen very closely to that sentence, the word "for" means because. Jesus was touched with the feeling of our infirmities because he was tempted in all points, like as we are. Our high priest was touched with the feeling of our infirmities because he was tempted in all points as we are. He suffered. Now, let me ask you this question. We're trying to think through these verses. What caused Jesus to suffer?
when he was tempted. We only have a few minutes left, but you still need to pray for me, because sometimes I can get very emotional when I get to studying this, and I'll try to hold myself and not get emotional. But I want to read to you a few statements in the Spirit of Prophecy about this, about how Jesus suffered when he was tempted. This one is Signs of the Times, December 9, 1897. The human nature of Christ was like unto ours, and suffering was more keenly felt by him. For his spiritual nature was free from every taint of sin. When he suffered, the suffering was more keenly felt by him than I feel the suffering, because his spiritual nature was free from every taint of sin. My spiritual nature is not free from every taint of sin. But his was. Now listen to this. I'm still quoting. Therefore, his desire for the removal of suffering was stronger than human beings can experience. You ever been suffering so bad that you would do anything in the world to get some relief? You ever been in that situation? When I was 22 years old, I was in the hospital. I had to do major surgery. I made an emergency surgery to save my life, or I'd have been dead that day. I knew when I went into surgery, either it was going to succeed or I would never wake up until the resurrection. I knew that. I didn't know which it would be. I just had to trust the Lord. The Lord decided, for reasons I can't explain, it wasn't my time to die that day. And I can still remember, as I was just starting to come to, and I was almost to get happy. I thought, is this the resurrection? And then, bang, the pain hit. I know, no, this is not the resurrection. So they said, well, we'll give you, used in those days, they do it different now, but in those days, used to give, for relief of pain, they give you pain injection about every 4 hours. Can't give you more often every 4 hours. I didn't want to take any more of that stuff than I had to. So I tried to go a little longer than 4 hours. Guess what? The pain gets ahead of you, and it gets so bad that even the injection doesn't even help you. And you get to the point where it seems like an hour has gone by, and you look at your watch, and it's been about 90 seconds since you looked at it before. And you'd give anything, everything you have, just to get some relief. But notice here, it says his desire for the removal of suffering was stronger than human beings can experience. Why did he have to go through that? I used to ask, I don't understand at all. All I know is that he had to go through that to save me. That's all I know about it. That's all I know about it. The spiritual nature of Jesus was free from every taint of sin. There was not one thread of selfishness in him, and this made his desire for the removal of suffering stronger, and therefore the strength of his temptation greater than you and I will ever have. Signs of the Times, January 6, 1881. Jesus was not insensible to ignominy. You know what ignominy is? That means you've been disgraced. You've been put to shame.
Did they put Jesus to shame when they crucified him? In every way possible.
He was not insensible to all that. Signs of the Times, January 6, 1881 again. Jesus was not insensible to ignominy. He felt the disgrace of sin as much more keenly than it is possible for man to feel it, as his divine and sinless nature was exalted above the nature of man. We should never entertain the thought
that the majesty of heaven, so holy and undefiled, was not acutely sensitive to scorn, mockery, abuse, and pain.
Don't ever think that he could take it easier than you. It was harder for him than you and me.
His divine and sinless nature that was exalted above the nature of man is his divinity combined with his sinless humanity. It was this combination that gave him the experience that would make him our sympathetic high priest.
He knows how you feel.
It was this combination that made him more sensible to ignominy, the disgrace of sin. Here's another one. Call to stand apart, page 26. He is our brother, a brother in our infirmities. In all points, tempted like as we are. But as the sinless one, his nature recoiled from evil. He endured struggles and torture of soul in a world of sin. Even though Jesus was in all points tempted as we are, his nature recoiled from evil because his human spiritual nature was sinless, free from every taint of sin, free from the seeds of selfishness. Selfishness was not a natural trait of character in the human nature of Christ as it is in us. And this parallels the exception that Paul made when he said that Christ was tempted in all points like us we are, yet without sin. All selfishness is covetousness and therefore idolatry and therefore sin. He endured struggles and torture of soul because his finite sinless nature was acutely sensitive to scorn and mockery and abuse and pain. Stop. Continue it later. Because we haven't gotten to where it goes yet.
My dear friend, before we go, I want you to think to this. He went through all of this because he wanted to save you. My dear friends, do you understand how serious God is about saving you? Do you understand, as we've studied this, that if you surrender your life to Him, there is no chance that He won't save you. He will save you. You just have to surrender and say, Lord, I want to be saved. I'm willing to surrender to You. I'm willing for You to be my master instead of the devil. I'm willing to obey You and Your laws instead of the devil and his laws. That's all you need to do. You can do that. He will save you. Doesn't matter what your past is. Doesn't matter what other people think about you. He will save you. Let's pray. Father in heaven, help us to comprehend just a little bit about what it means when it says that He was in all points tempted like we are, yet without sin. And Lord, as we commit ourselves to Him, help us to realize and trust Him and to know that He will save us if we commit ourselves to Him. And we pray that He may be our only Lord and Master forever. In His name we pray. Amen.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org, and our web address is www.stepstolife.org. May God be with you as you seek to walk the narrow way.